Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents The Age of Zeus by James Lovegrove, narrated by Andy Cresswell. Prologue, Corsica. Finally, the monster was at bay. It had been flushed out of the forest. It had been hounded downhill, bullets smacking at its heels and wanging into the trunks of oaks and other mountain broadleafs on either side of it. It had been shepherded by gunfire into the village and driven along the streets. At last, it had been corralled into a cul-de-sac with high, ancient walls on either side. Cornered, panting, torso lathered in sweat, the monster turned. Two of its pursuers were approaching from the open end of the cul-de-sac. Above, in the upper stories of the stone-built houses, shutters opened a crack and villagers peeped out. Their faces were fearful but hopeful. The monster had been terrorizing the Corsican interior for months, killing at random. Now it itself was the one being terrorized. The villagers were eager to see the monster get its comeuppance. Long overdue. But the monster was still dangerous. Just because it was trapped, that didn't mean it was helpless. It was, after all, the Minotaur, 7 feet tall and 400 pounds of hyper-developed muscle and skin-straining sinew, with the strength of several oxen. Lowering its head, the Minotaur fixed its blood-red eyes on its foes and pawed the ground with 1 foot. Breath snorted from its nostrils in short, thick gusts.
Tethys, Hyperion, what is your status?
Sam did not take her gaze off the Minotaur, specifically not off the pair of huge horns that were now pointing towards her like two ivory spears.
Hyperion, Tethys, Mnemosyne and I are in range of target. It's about to charge.
Do you have line of sight?
Roger.
Do you have a clear shot?
Roger.
Then what are you dicking about for? Take it.
Sam raised her recoilless 45mm submachine gun. It was boxy and lightweight, a skeletal weapon, blisteringly effective nonetheless. The Minotaur saw it, understood its purpose. It was familiar with guns. It knew what they did. In those red eyes, Sam saw the flash of comprehension, and something else. She couldn't be sure, but she thought it looked like resignation. Which was impossible. The Minotaur was an unthinking creature, a mindless force of destruction. There was nothing in that bull head but malevolence and the basic animal cunning needed to survive. Or so she'd been given to believe. The Minotaur couldn't know that it was about to die. Could it?
Tethys, Hyperion's voice. Do you copy? I said take the shot.
Sam's finger curled round the trigger. The Minotaur bent low, tensing. It would charge for all the good that would do. These armor-clad enemies were like nothing it had come up against before. It knew it was outclassed. For the first time in its life, the Minotaur was staring defeat in the eye, and defeat shadow, death. But it would not give in meekly. That was not in the nature of this beast.
Tethys, said Mnemosyne.
She had her coil gun aimed at the monster's center of body mass.
Sam, what are you waiting for? This is our chance.
Tethys, barked Hyperion over the comms net. Why am I not hearing a kill shot?
The Minotaur was ready. Sam could tell by its posture. One last attack. A final act of defiance against the inevitable.
Mnemosyne, she said, I want to try and take it alive, if I can.
What?
Said Mnemosyne.
What?
Exclaimed Hyperion. Sam's transponder sensor was registering his presence nearby, lower in the village, 200 meters southeast, and closing. She had to do this before he got here. Hyperion, Ramsey, would have no qualms about making the kill. This was not any kind of retrieval op. This was supposed to be an execution.
I'll use the stun dusters, she said to Mnemosyne.
You're crazy! Why?
Sam couldn't say why. She wasn't totally sure herself.
Trust me, please.
Mnemosyne left a moment of silence to convey doubt. Then she said,
All right, go on.
She firmed her grip on the coil gun.
But I'm keeping this trained on it at all times.
Cronus gave us a non-lethal offensive capability for a reason, Sam said, fitting a pair of rigid metal knuckle dusters onto her gauntlets.
Let's hope the reason wasn't to kill ourselves,
Mnemosyne replied. Sam grunted. Already, a little over a month after the commencement of operations, two Titans were dead. Today, at least one more could be about to join them, and this time it would be their own fault. Her fault, to be exact. Abruptly, the Minotaur charged. Sam braced herself. Mnemosyne, meanwhile, stepped back and took aim. Hyperion was yelling,
Don't be stupid! Kill shot! Motherfucking kill shot!
The beast came fast, so fast, barreling at them like a runaway goods van. Sam knew that if she fucked this up, it was all over.
Then don't fuck it up, she told herself,
and ran to meet the monster.
Part 1. 3 months earlier. Chapter 1. The Chicagoan. There were two of them waiting on the quay, Sam and the man she had first encountered a couple of hours ago on the train, the man who'd been carrying an invitation like hers. She had spotted him in the buffet car as she was returning to her carriage from a trip to the toilet. He was ordering a cheese sandwich and a club soda. African-American, tall, well put together, nice, firm buttocks. Standing straight-spined, so much so that everyone around him seemed to slouch by comparison. Chicago accent? Yes, Chicago. Chewy on the syllables. He was very handsome. In particular, she'd liked his nose, the nostrils of which were naturally flared, a sign of self-assurance and the right kind of pride. And while he waited for the woman behind the counter to fetch his food and pour his drink, he'd taken the invitation out of his pocket to inspect it. Doubtless not for the first time. Identical to the one Sam had in her handbag, printed on snowdrift smooth card in an elegant formal font, the kind of thing you might expect to receive from the host of a truly classy party. The Chicagoan had frowned at it, shaken his head, then tucked it away again. In the time he'd spent studying the invitation, Sam could have gone up to him, produced her own, said something like, Snap, or You show me yours, now I'll show you mine. Something coy and wry like that, and introduced herself. But she hadn't. She'd just slipped past the man and gone onto her seat, and the train had continued rumbling on its way, towards the terminus from where she was to catch a taxi to the coast, to this stony little port town, this quay. The Chicagoan was now sitting on a mooring post. He had his Macintosh collar turned up all the way to his chin and was huddled in on himself, looking miserable in the damp, bitter wind that was gusting on shore. It was a freezing, early January day. Sea and sky appeared to be in competition as to which was murkier and more tormented. Gulls plodded along the slick stones of the harbour wall, beaks to breasts, feathers ruffled. Sam stood off at a distance from the man, sheltering in the doorway of a fish and chip shop, which, according to the sign hanging on its door, was open, but looked very firmly closed. She knew the Chicagoan had clocked her, and had identified that she was there for the same reason he was, both of them answering the same oblique, enigmatic summons. The small suitcase at her feet gave the game away. He had an item of luggage, too. An overnight bag with wheels and an extendable handle. But he seemed to respect the fact that she didn't want to strike up a conversation with him. At least, not just yet. Out of the corner of her eye, Sam spied a group of people approaching along the main harbourside street. More invitees? No. A young couple with two kids, one of them in a pushchair. Winter holiday makers. The adults were bent forward against the wind, and the face of the older child, a boy of 8 or 9, was one big scowl, angrily baffled as to why his parents had insisted on dragging him outside in such foul weather when he could be warm indoors with the TV and his Nintendo. The baby, by contrast, was snugly bundled up and blissfully asleep. They passed by Sam on their way to the tip of the quay. She nodded to the parents and deliberately didn't look at either of the children, especially not the baby. The family returned soon afterwards, and with grim jollity, the father remarked to her, "Bracing?" She nodded again, and this time couldn't prevent her gaze straying to the sleeping infant. Just a child. Just somebody else's child. But so small, so serene in slumber, so chubbily, cherubically complete. Sam's throat caught. Her gut knotted. She felt as if she were plummeting in an express elevator. Her counselor had told her there would always be moments like this. However much time went by, the feelings would never fully go away and would sometimes catch her unawares, pouncing like a tiger from the underbrush. She simply had to bear it, work through it. The moments, like all moments, would pass. She focused on the coldness of the air, the salt tang of the wind, the rank smell of fish and cooking fat that emanated from behind her, sensations from the present, her immediate surroundings, reality, now. The past belonged to the past. Gradually, her breathing returned to normal. The dizziness abated, her stomach unclenched. She was herself again. A small wooden-hulled fishing smack came chugging into the harbour. It drew up alongside the quay, and the captain stepped up to the gunwales and called out,
"Bleeny Island! Any here for Bleeny Island?"
Both Sam and the Chicagoan went over to the boat, and the captain helped them aboard.
"You'd be the last two, then," he said.
Ruddy-cheeked, bushy-sideburned, twinkly-eyed, he was the living epitome of a fishing smack owner.
"If you say so," said the Chicagoan. "How many others have there been?" 10, all told. 3 trips I've done today, there and back. Why you couldn't all come at once, I don't know. But then, what do I care? I'm getting paid by the journey, and good money, too."
He started up the engine, brought the boat about, and soon they were pulling out of the harbour, onto the open sea. Other than the wheelhouse, which had room for the captain only, there was no cover on deck. Sam sat on an upturned plastic crate, while the Chicagoan stood, hands in pockets, peering ahead to the horizon. He looked at ease, comfortable despite the smacks dipping and yawning, his legs bent slightly to help him ride the swell. Eventually, he turned to Sam.
"About time we met," he said. "Can't go on ignoring each other forever."
He stuck out a hand.
"Rick Ramsey."
"Sam Akehurst."
They shook. His grip was tough, gnarled, tight.
"I noticed you on the train," he said.
"You did?"
She couldn't mask her surprise.
"You're hard not to notice."
His eye roved, returned.
"When I was buying that goddamn awful sandwich made of cardboard and rubber, how do you Brits eat that stuff?"
"We don't," Sam replied. "Only tourists are daft enough to try."
Rick Ramsey grinned dazzlingly.
"Touché. That's when I spotted you anyways. And you did your darndest to ignore me."
"In your dreams, Casanova."
"Whatever. So what's going on? What's your take on all this?"
He didn't have to specify what he meant by all this.
"I have no idea," Sam said. "All I know is what it says here."
She took out her invitation, which read, "Miss Samantha Akehurst. You are hereby invited to attend a gathering which may lead to a proposition advantageous to yourself. Your personal circumstances are known to me. Your opportunity to seek redress has arrived." The invitation was unsigned. A date, location, and suggested travel arrangements were printed on the reverse. A check to cover costs, generously, had also been enclosed in the envelope.
"Yeah," said Ramsey. "Fancy, huh? I had to look up redress in the dictionary. I thought maybe it had something to do with drag queens.
No, you didn't, Sam thought. You're a damn sight smarter than you choose to let on.
Tweaked my curiosity all the same, he went on. I thought, if nothing else, it's an all-expenses trip to merry old England. Why not go? Do this, then pop down to see Stonehenge and maybe pay the Queen a visit at Buckingham Palace.
So you're not the sort who normally responds to anonymous, vaguely worded invitations that drop on your doormat?
As a rule, no. And neither, I would guess, Sam Akehurst, are you. And yet here we are. What's that say about us, I wonder?
No life?
Ramsay gave a husky chortle, like rainwater gurgling down a downpipe.
Ain't that the truth?
Chapter 2. On Bleeny Island. Bleeny Island was a low-lying hump of land, like the corpse of some vast, ancient ocean leviathan, dead in the water. Between outcrops of bare black rock, there were stretches of grass and gorse, and the remnants of dry stone walls could be seen, still parceling up the ground decades after the last settlers had left. A concrete jetty jutted out from a steep shingle beach, and a small man hunched inside a large, puffy parka was waiting at the end of it to greet the boat and the new arrivals.
"Jolly on lilycrap,"
he said, blinking through spectacles misted with sea spray. "Apologies for both names. Neither my fault, but each nonetheless in its own way a source of embarrassment. Captain Fuller radioed ahead to tell us you were en route. It's Rick and Samantha, right?"
"Sam," said Sam. "Nobody's ever called me Samantha apart from my parents."
The fishing smack reversed, came about, and swung away in a cloud of diesel smoke, Captain Fuller bidding farewell with a double blare of his horn.
"Let's go," said Lilycrap, shivering. "It's not getting any warmer. This way, step lively."
He trotted along the jetty onto a track that curved between two shallow folds of hill. Sam and Ramsay followed, walking fast to keep up. Lilycrap seemed a creature of brisk, nervous energy coupled with impatient efficiency.
"Excuse me," said Sam. "Mr. Lilycrap, Jolyon, where are you taking us? Are you the one who invited us here?"
"Questions," said Lilycrap over his shoulder. "I'm not supposed to answer any questions."
"Well, I think that answers your second one," Ramsay muttered to Sam. "Monkey, not organ grinder."
The track terminated at a cave-like entrance set into the earth, braced all round by poured concrete and inset with heavy steel doors. As the three of them drew near, the doors rolled ponderously open, activated by a remote control from Lilycrap's pocket.
"What is this fucking hobbit land?" Ramsay said with a grimace. "We gonna meet Gandalf?"
"Second World War bunker, actually," said Lilycrap. "Bleeny Island was used as a listening post, keeping an ear on German naval radio traffic and U-boat sonar pings in the North Sea. It was also to be a last readout if things started to go wrong. Churchill and the rest of the war cabinet would have been spirited away here to, I don't know, make patriotic broadcasts while the Nazis hoisted the swastika over the Houses of Parliament, something like that. The bunker was completely derelict until about 7 years ago when we started work. Don't worry, we've made it quite an agreeable place to live. Central heating, ventilation, the lot. Damp's still a problem in a few places, but otherwise it's all perfectly civilized."
"Perfectly civilized," Ramsay echoed. "How come that phrase sends a chill down the back of my neck?"
"Because you're not British?" Sam offered.
"That'd do it."
The steel doors began to trundle shut behind them. Simultaneously, overhead lights came on, revealing a pillared, low-ceilinged space like a story of a parking garage. The walls were streaked with the crusty white residue of dried moisture. The floor was dotted with what looked like large wet blisters, build-ups of sediment, proto-stalagmites. Lilycrap briskly crossed this empty area, making to the far side, and a door whose locking mechanism was controlled by a handprint scanner. Sam had been beginning to wonder if perhaps she and Ramsay were the victims of some grand, elaborate hoax, and there was no more to this dingy, subterranean place than met the eye. The handprint scanner put pay to that. There was, self-evidently, a great deal more. A broad corridor led them past a series of closed doors. Rock music thumped from behind one. Living quarters, she guessed. At the end lay a staircase, down which they went, Sam with a deepening sense of trepidation. What was she getting herself into? There was the feeling that she was descending into something inescapable, irrevocable. She could be about to disappear off the face of the earth. No one knew she had gone to this island. There were no witnesses to her travelling here except for Captain Fuller, and he was in the employ of whoever had organised this whole enterprise. If she vanished, who would notice? Nobody. That was the sad truth of her existence. She had no family, no close friends, not anymore. Tragic though this was, it was also perversely comforting. Whatever fate awaited her, it would affect her alone. Sam Akehurst would not be missed. Her absence would not leave a hole in anyone's life. No less comforting was the presence of Rick Ramsay. If this situation was all some elaborate trap, a snare for the curious and unwary, she didn't think he would hesitate to fight his way out of it, and neither would she. Lillycrap ushered them into a cramped, cluttered room that was mostly taken up by a large table. Seated around it were 10 men and women, all of them in various stages of boredom and disaffection. Refreshments, sandwiches, pastries, dips, were heaped on the tabletop, largely untouched. Coffee and tea-making facilities perched on a trolley in one corner. "Make yourselves at home," Lillycrap said to Sam and Ramsay. "And the rest of you, it won't be much longer now, I promise."
"No worries,"
said a sunburned man in a sardonic Australian drawl.
"Tell your boss to take his time. I've got nothing else to do but sit around all day with my thumb up my freckle."
Lillycrap sniffed and withdrew, leaving Sam and Ramsay as the focus of 10 scrutinizing gazes. Sam tried a disarming smile, put on rather than felt. Ramsay got more of a result simply by saying,
"The coffee in that pot better not be the watered-down piss it looks like."
Someone chuckled, and the atmosphere lightened a little. Sam sat down in the last remaining chair but one, between a sharp-nosed blonde woman and an Asian male. The latter, in almost entirely unaccented English, introduced himself as Fred Tsang. The blonde favoured Sam with nothing more than a reserved nod. Ramsay placed a coffee in front of Sam, which she was grateful for, even though she hadn't asked for it. He then took the final seat, sipped from his own cup, wrinkled his nose, and confirmed aloud that it was indeed watered-down piss.
"So," he said, having drained the cup anyway, "which one of us gets murdered first?"
You Yankee bastard," said the Australian cheerily.
"It's just I'm getting a whole Agatha Christie vibe from this," Ramsay continued, pointedly disregarding the other man's comment. 12 folks gathered in a room together, cut off from the mainland, brought here by a complete stranger. Where's Miss Marple when you need her?"
"Not cut off," said a woman,
another American, black like Ramsay, but lighter skinned, most likely mixed race. She held up a mobile phone.
"Not as long as we've got ourselves."
"Reception?" The woman checked.
"Oh, nah-uh."
"Didn't think so. Underground. Cut off, then. Nolens?"
"Just outside. Chalmet. Chicago?"
"Southside, born and raised."
"Kayla," said the woman. "Kayla Sparks."
"I'm Rick," said Ramsay. "And the lovely redhead with me is Sam. She's English, so she doesn't talk much."
"Prefers not to," said Sam.
"Same difference," said Ramsay. "But seeing as the two of us are the newcomers, and even though the rest of you have been here a while and probably already know a bit about one another, would you mind filling us in about yourselves, so we're up to speed?
Then we can maybe figure out what the 12 of us have in common, other than being invited here, and try and make sense of this thing. How about that?
Did I miss the voting? Challenged the Australian. Did you just put yourself in charge, Septic?
No, Crocodile Dundee, I haven't put myself in charge of anything. But if you'd like me to...
No way, mate. Spent 13 years of my life taking orders. I'm done with it now.
I doubt you ever did take orders. Not really.
Too right.
No, all I was doing was making a straightforward request, not a leadership bid, said Ramsay. Like I said, to get Sam and me up to speed. Would that be okay? The Australian deliberated.
Can't see the harm?
Good. Then let's start with you.
Who are you, and why have you come all this way from the lucky country to this godforsaken spot?
Chapter 3. The Barracuda. Des, the Barracuda Barrington, was his name. And the why of it was simple. He was a man with a grudge, a man seeking payback. And that was what the invitation in its ponced-up, wowsery way had promised.
Payback for?
It's not something I like to talk about.
I'd say relax, you're among friends, said Ramsay. Except you're not, so I won't. I could save you the trouble of having to reveal all, though, by making an educated guess.
Barrington spread out two beefy pink hands, palms up.
Go ahead, smartass. Be my guest.
The Olympians. Something the Olympians did to you.
The word Olympians set a frisson around the table, bringing a stiffening of backs, a compressing of lips. Sam felt herself bristle along with everyone else. Couldn't help it. She couldn't hear the Olympians mentioned, couldn't read about them in the newspaper, couldn't catch a glimpse of them on television without her whole body starting to tense up, often to the point of trembling. For her, it was as much of an instinctive reaction as dread of a shark or revulsion at a snake. She was not alone in that. Certainly not in this room.
You knew already,
said Barrington, both a question and an accusation.
How?
I don't know. Maybe you're the bloke that brought us all here. You act like you are.
I'm as much in the dark as any of you, Ramsay said, just trying to fumble my way towards the light. The Olympians hurt someone you care about. Maybe did worse than hurt. Correct?
Barrington gave a sullen, crumpled nod.
Malk, my brother. Older brother. Only member of my family worth a tinker's fart. Couldn't have been my vicious bastard of a father who got killed, could it? Couldn't have been my drunk of a mother or my slag of a sister who'll drop her grundies for every root rat that comes sniffing round. Had to be Malcolm, the only person in the world I've ever had any respect for.
I'm sorry for your loss.
Me bloody too, mate.
Was it intentional?
Nah. Malk just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Hercules was having one of his hissy fits, storming through downtown Sydney, flinging cars around and punching holes in buildings. His latest bum boy had given him the elbow. That's what I heard. Ended their affair. So off Herc the jerk goes. Taking it out on property like he does, the great arse.
Malk was working on the third floor of an office block on George Street, fixing a water cooler for a legal firm. A fucking Toyota Ute came flying through the window. Killed him stone dead. Barrington's face had gone a deeper, fiercer shade of red. His voice was a bald fist.
Act of God, the police report said. Act of bastard, more like. Still, four lawyers died too, so it wasn't a complete disaster.
Around the table, there were looks of sympathy and of empathy. Sam could feel it as strongly as Barrington did, the rage, the pain, the sense of injustice and impotence.
She marvelled at how quickly that Ramsay had managed to get to the nub of things. A clever man, just as she'd thought. He'd intuited the common denominator that tied all 12 of them together. Although, if her hunch was correct, it wasn't the only common denominator.
"You lost somebody too, eh?" Barrington said to Ramsay. "That's it, isn't it? That's how you knew."
"My son, Ethan. He was 7 years old. He would have turned 12 next month."
Ramsay's tone was matter-of-fact, and Sam wondered how hard he'd worked to be able to keep it that way while talking about this subject.
"Not a day goes by that I don't think of him, wondering how he'd look now, things he'd say, what he'd be interested in. He was a great kid, handsome like his daddy, biggest, brownest eyes you ever saw. And one afternoon he was at school, it was recess, he was out in the yard messing around with his pals, swapping baseball cards, talking about comics, whatever, doing boy stuff. And the monster got him."
"Monster?" said Fred Sang. "Which one?"
"The Lamia. Goddamn blood-sucking, child-murdering bitch." Ethan's elementary school was right on the shore of Lake Michigan. Lamia came out of the lake, went into the schoolyard, grabbed a kid, one kid only, mine, and picked him up and drained the life out of him, right there in front of the whole class. Threw his empty body back down like it was a Coke can and was gone back into the water before anybody could so much as move."
"I lost a child too,"
said a man in his early 40s with salt and pepper hair, a product of the English boarding school system by the look and sound of him. Imprinted with the classics, corners knocked off him on the rugby pitch, licked into shape by the headmaster's cane.
"A daughter. My wife along with her. We were on holiday, Crete. Poseidon and Zeus were having a blazing row, somewhere down the coast from us. One of their spats, you know how those two are. Poseidon feeling unappreciated. His old complaint about when the gods were dividing up the earthly regions, all he got was the sea and none of the land, kicking up a fuss about that, and Zeus having to read the riot act, bring him back into line. Poseidon went off in a huff, decided to end the argument with a tidal wave. I was taking a nap in the hotel at the time, blissfully unaware of what was happening just a few miles to the west. Debs, my wife, she and Megan were down on the beach. Beautiful, hot day. Then suddenly this noise, this enormous roar of water. By the time I'd got to the balcony to look out, the beach was gone, just swept away. Sucked out to sea, leaving bare rock behind. The sand all gone, and everyone on it as well. It's Chisholm, by the way. Nigel Chisholm. I used to be a pilot. Still am, technically. Though I haven't flown a plane in years." "My husband," said the blonde woman next to Sam.
Her accent was Teutonic, with that slight American lilt typical of Europeans who'd learned their idiomatic English via Hollywood.
"Dietrich, army officer, killed 6.5 years ago during my country's final stupid show of defiance against the Olympians."
"The Munich massacre," said Ramsay.
"So," she confirmed. 9,000 of our troops and almost as many civilians were slaughtered that day. Also that our chancellor could pretend he had a dick bigger than my little finger. Dietrich was one of the 9,000. A small fraction of the total. A tiny, insignificant statistic. But he was my husband. My soulmate. My name is Kirsten, if you must know. Kirsten Harryhausen."
"You what?" exclaimed Ramsay. "You're shitting me."
"No, no shitting," said Harryhausen. "Why, is it an amusing name?"
"No, it's just, well, ironic."
"Kirsten is ironic."
"Harryhausen? You mean you haven't heard of..."
He stopped.
"Oh, I get it. You're messing with my head, aren't you?"
"I am messing with your head, Mr. Ramsay,"
the German said, deadpan.
Of course, I know the Harryhausen you speak of. The great stop-motion animator, hm? You aren't the first to remark on a certain significance in my surname, and you surely won't be the last.
I apologize for being so unoriginal. Moving on. Ramsay turned to Kayla Sparks. How about you, Ms. Sparks? What's your story?
Grandmother, she said. Aunt, uncle.
She fingered a tiny gold crucifix that hung on a chain around her neck.
The Hydra got them, few years back.
And you? Ramsay said to Fred Tsang.
My family, most of my relatives, my friends, more or less everyone I ever knew.
Hong Kong, yeah?
Tsang nodded.
The obliteration, back near the start, when the Olympians were just beginning to exert their influence. I was out of the province on a trip to mainland China, escorting a Beijing man home, a bank robber who'd skipped bail. I should mention I was a senior inspector of the HK Police Tactical Unit. The Olympians, as you know, decided to make an example of a city, to demonstrate just what they were capable of, to show that they were not to be trifled with. Hong Kong was the city they chose. And Hong Kong
is no more.
Precisely, Mr. Ramsay. Hong Kong is no more. All those houses, those skyscrapers, several million people, just so much rubble and dust. I'm one of the last few Hong Kongers left.
Tsang's face appeared placid, but there was no mistaking the glint of bitter anguish in his eyes.
I'm still kept awake at night, he said, by guilt, mostly. I find myself wishing I had been there when it happened, and had died with everyone else. To a certain extent, I did die. A part of me has not been alive ever since.
A pang swelled to fill Sam's chest. Tsang had articulated something she herself had long been feeling.
I myself did not lose any relative, said a somber-faced man with a receding hairline. He sounded, to Sam's ears, Scandinavian. I lost men, by which I mean troops I was responsible for. Anders Sondergaard. I was a tank commander with the Danish Jytske Dragon Regiment, the Jutland Dragoon Regiment. My squadron was wiped out during the Battle of Sjaland, as were so many others. My own tank, a Leopard 2, was destroyed by Ares himself, with three good crewmen inside. How I survived, it was a miracle, although a miracle that left me hospitalized for 6 months. I still bear the marks.
He rolled up one shirt sleeve to show an arm sheathed in warped, waxy skin from wrist to elbow, scar tissue from second-degree burns.
And believe me, that's not the worst of it, he added, rebuttoning his cuff. To say I hate the Olympians would be an understatement. I despise them.
The admissions continued. A Cameroonian by the name of Sole Eto'o, moon face, tight short cornrows, her skin so matte black it had a bluish tinge, had watched her parents burn to death in their home village, victims of a reprisal attack by the Olympians during their efforts to stamp out the resistance movement in that country. Sole had immediately joined the resistance herself, and ever since had been helping to conduct a guerrilla campaign against the Olympians all across Africa. A Muslim woman from Manchester, Zaina Mahmoud, had lost her two brothers while they were on Hajj to Mecca. Several Olympians had laid into the crowd of pilgrims circling round the Kaaba, simply in order to prove that there were no deities worth worshipping but them. The irony was, neither Hamid nor Asif, her brothers, was particularly devout. They just fancied making the trip and seeing what all the fuss was about. A handsome, tough-looking Quebecoese, Teresa Hamel, had had a dear friend taken from her. The Olympians' fault, of course. She didn't divulge details, but by that point didn't need to. The tales of tragedy were becoming banal, the bereavements, by accumulation, almost routine. Of the 12, only two remained who hadn't told their stories yet. One was Sam. The other was a pale-complexioned, ferrety-faced man who, unlike the rest of them, had so far evinced very little in the way of emotion. He had an air about him that Sam recognized, enclosed and self-contained, as if he were someone who had learned to keep his mouth shut and his innermost thoughts private, someone who knew the value of silence. In her former life, back when she had had a life, she'd met countless people like this. Everything about him said to her that he had not walked the straight and narrow and had more likely served a stretch or two at Her Majesty's pleasure. Ramsay now addressed him.
"And you, sir?"
The man glanced up, seemingly surprised, as though he'd been paying attention to none of the preceding conversation.
"Me?"
"Yeah, you," said Ramsay. "How do you fit in with us?"
"To be honest, I don't. 'Cause unlike you lot, I've got nothing to blub and whinge about. It was my missus they got. Ex-missus, sort of. We were separated. Separating. And I'll tell you what, they did me a favour and all. That fucking cow, she got what she deserved, and the world's better off without her."
That brought a pause to the proceedings. Eyebrows were raised. Awkward glances were exchanged across the table. Barrington broke the silence.
"I'll say this for you, mate. You speak your mind. And for a pom, that's as rare as washing. You have a name?"
"Darren."
"Darren?"
"Darren'll do for now."
"Well, Darren'll do for now. Put her there."
Barrington held out a hand. The other man just stared at it.
"Or don't," said Barrington, withdrawing. "See if I care."
11 down, 1 to go, said Ramsay. "Sam, you're up."
Sam shot him a pleading look.
"Come on," he chided. "It's not so hard. You've just heard everyone. We've all been there, with the possible exception of Darren. Bring it out. Share."
"I don't..."
Sam was saved by the sound of the door opening. All heads turned as a man entered the room. He was slim, dapper, silver-haired, none too tall, with sharply pointed eyebrows and a trim goatee. He wore a tailored, charcoal-grey suit, and overall had the sleek, distinguished look of somebody who possessed a great deal of money and was in no way ashamed of the fact. Wealth fitted him much like the suit, lightly and neatly.
"I do apologize for keeping you," said this man, who could only be the instigator of the invitations, the reason they were all here. "Some last-minute details that demanded my attention. I trust you've taken the opportunity to get to know one another. My name is Regis Landesman. You're wondering who I am, why I've asked you to come to this place, and what I have to offer you. In truth, what really counts is what you have to offer me. I will show you what I mean in a moment or so. But first, if you'll indulge me, I have a few words to say."
Chapter 4. Regis Landesman. "Doubtless," said Regis Landesman, "none of you will have heard of me. That's the way I prefer it. Unlike many who have achieved a comparable level of worldly success, I shun the limelight. I have never had any interest in publicizing myself. I refuse to espouse charitable causes the way others of my kind do, so as to make themselves seem philanthropic or caring, a time-consuming and hypocritical exercise, if you ask me. I have, for the majority of my 50-odd years on this planet, been a pure businessman. A capitalist of the old school, interested solely in profit, driven by the bottom line, motivated by the margin. I make no bones about it. It has served me well. I have amassed a fortune. Some might say several fortunes through a trade that most would consider abhorrent. My line of work is not for those troubled by an excess of conscience. Plainly put, I am an arms manufacturer.
My company, Daedalus Industries, has supplied everything from bullets to jet fighters, landmines to armored personnel carriers to any country prepared to pay for such items. Meaning, of course, every country. Fully one-tenth of the world's existing stockpile of munitions and ordnance originated in a Daedalus subsidiary factory. You can regard me as a merchant of death, a creator of misery, a mass murderer even. I've been called all of those things in my time, and worse. Doesn't bother me in the slightest. Somebody has to make weapons. If I didn't do it, someone else would. To me, it's that straightforward.
Business must have dropped off lately, though, said Ramsay, since the Olympians came on the scene.
Quite so, Mr. Ramsay. Or may I call you Rick?
Ramsay shrugged. It's all the same to me.
In the past few years, I've been obliged to close down nearly half of my plants, Landesman said. Laid off many thousands of workers. There are still deals to be done these days, but far fewer than before, and often with clients of the less desirable kind. Now that every national standing army has been reduced to a rump, government contracts are less forthcoming and are hotly contested by my rivals, with the result that severe undercutting has to go on, and any revenue one makes scarcely covers one's overheads. It is not a happy situation. Our share price is a shadow of its former self, and some of the wittier stockbrokers have taken to calling the company Dead Loss Industries. Although you might be relieved to hear that income-wise, I personally, through judicious husbanding of savings and prudent investment, am unaffected.
Strike me blind, are you for real? Said Barrington. Way you talk, it's like something out of Flaming Jane Austen.
I shall take that as a compliment, Mr. Barrington.
You can take it however you like, mate.
I could, Landesman resumed, resent the Olympians, the entire Pantheon as a whole, for causing the severe contraction of what was once an expansive and lucrative business empire. I should. In a sense, I do. They are the ones who, by taking it upon themselves to establish and enforce a regime of peace all across the world, have knocked the bottom out of the war market. But it would be churlish of me to deny that their rise to prominence has brought with it a global stability the like of which has never been known. We all must acknowledge this as a fact. Your faces disagree, but you nevertheless must concede that over the past decade and more, the world has experienced no major conflicts, not one, nor any minor ones. For the first time in history, there is no region where the human race is engaged in factional infighting, civil war, religion-based strife, a battle for resources, any kind of large-scale person-against-person fighting. Power blocks are no longer flexing their muscles. Terrorists are no longer targeting civilians with bombs, suicide, and otherwise. Territorial tussles are a thing of the past. And who do we have to thank for that? Zeus and co. You may not like it, but you know that it is so.
But they are murderers, said Anders Sornegard.
They have killed to further their aims and continue to kill recklessly, sometimes deliberately.
Wouldn't you rather have that, the odd death here and there as the price for overall peace? Isn't that, in the broad scheme of things, a fair exchange?
No, said Sornegard. And the sentiment was echoed around the table.
But think about it, said Landesman. The Olympians have picked off every dangerous religious fundamentalist leader there is. They've eliminated every single tyrant and tinpot dictator, not least the ones with nuclear ambitions. Warmongers, oppressors, right-wing extremist cells, despots, jumped-up paramilitary lunatics everywhere, all gone, assassinated, eradicated. Only democratically elected politicians remain in power, and they're all too cowed to start any kind of trouble, knowing it would bring the wrath of the Pantheon down on their heads. They've even handed over the keys to the world's nuclear arsenals to the Olympians, so the spectre of mutually assured destruction, or of even a limited nuclear skirmish, no longer hovers over us.
and the funds originally earmarked for war budgets have been diverted to schools, hospitals, care homes, civil engineering projects, research into forms of renewable energy, just as the Greens and the Peacenik Brigade have been campaigning for ages. Isn't this the kind of society we're supposed to have been working towards? The end point of the human narrative. Every nation in harmony. Rogue states under control. Planet-wide détente. Better use of natural resources. Isn't this paradise? Utopia? We have gods in charge of us now. Surely that's desirable, preferable to being at the whim and mercy of mere fallible men.
They ain't gods, said Sparks with a vehement nod.
Are they not, Miss Sparks? Said Landesman. They certainly look that way to me. The ancient Greek pantheon in the flesh.
I read somewhere they're aliens, said Mahmood.
Do you believe that?
That's what some people say. Not just the barn pots, some scientists even. They've come from outer space and taken on a recognizable humanoid shape and are using their powers to save us from ourselves. Only they don't have powers,
Harryhausen chimed in.
Just incredibly advanced technology made to look like godlike powers.
And there's another theory, said Zhang. It goes that the Olympians are creations of Mother Earth. They have sprung up from the collective consciousness. I can't remember it, but there's a specific word for them.
Avatars, said Chisholm.
That's the one, avatars of nature. You've heard that one too?
Oh yes, said Chisholm. I've studied the Olympians in great depth. They've become quite a little hobby of mine. I've scoured the internet, read the books and newspaper articles, watched the documentaries. The Gaia self-defense mechanism hypothesis, that's the name for what you're talking about. Essentially, the Olympians are the planetary ecosystem's response to our species' rapacity and destructiveness, a kind of environmental failsafe. They've manifested from the pool of our dreams, conforming to a pre-existing set of archetypes, and the purpose of their presence is to curb our violent tendencies and steer us off the path of self-annihilation that we're on. Chisholm laughed hollowly. I think it's a load of old tosh myself, but this kind of wild supposition is only to be expected. In the absence of any hard facts about the Olympians, there'll inevitably be crackpots coming out with harebrained ideas.
You have your own theory about them, then? Asked Barrington. All that research you've done, you've got to.
Sorry to disappoint, but no. Frankly, I have no idea who or what they are. Nor do I think it matters. Knowing the truth of the Olympians' origins wouldn't lessen my contempt for them one little bit. Yours either, I'd imagine.
So it seems we all hate the Olympians, Mr. Landesman, said Therese Hamel. Apart from you, are you here to try and convert us? Is that what all this is about? You're some kind of emissary? An evangelist? You want to help us, cure us of our loathing somehow?
Did I say I approved of the Olympians, Miss Hamel?
You appear to.
Equally, I might merely be advancing an argument, putting a positive spin on their achievements, showing how their arrival and intervention has unquestionably had some benefits. After all, their avowed intent has always been the protection and nurturing of ordinary people. Zeus himself has said so, hasn't he? On numerous occasions. I recall his speech to the United Nations, the day the Olympians first made themselves known to the world. We have come here, incarnate again, in order to save you from the worst among you. We are here to liberate you from fear and the shadow of war. We want nothing more than for the human race to be free to live lives of contentment and mutual prosperity. A noble goal, without a doubt. As a mission statement, it can't be faulted.
Oh, yes, it can, said Sam.
Miss Akehurst? Landesman raised his eyebrows, inviting her to expound.
Well, it's self-evidently flawed, Sam said, after a moment's pause to collect her thoughts. There's implied coercion. Between the lines, that's a threat. It's not an offer, it's an order. Behave or else. And that's how the Olympians have been ruling us. We do as they want, or suffer.
and if we fail to toe the line, they back up the threat with violence, or else send one of their monsters to do their dirty work for them. All of which you know perfectly well, Mr. Landesman. I think you detest the Olympians as strongly as any of us, maybe more so. This grand speech of yours has simply been a way of gauging how the 12 of us feel, a test of sorts, as well as a way of stoking us up so that we'll be all hot and bothered and keen to find out what it is you actually want from us.
Landesman smiled broadly. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Akehurst was until not so long ago a detective sergeant with the London Metropolitan Police Force, on the fast track, well on her way to becoming one of the Met's youngest ever detective inspectors, before her career was, shall we say, diverted. Clearly, in the intervening period, her mind has lost none of its acuity and deductive capability. She is entirely right. I have been leading you up the garden path somewhat. I have been testing you. Brava, Miss Akehurst. I am most impressed.
Had Sam discerned even a hint of a patronizing tone in Landesman's voice, she would have been on him like a lioness on a zebra. To all appearances, though, his comments were sincere, his admiration genuine. Not that she liked flattery much either.
Then while I'm your star pupil, Mr. Landesman, she said, let me tell you something else I've figured out.
Go for it, murmured Ramsay.
We each of us have a personal reason for wanting to get back at one or more of the Pantheon. Rick spotted that almost from the off. But my feeling is there's something else, an additional criterion for us being selected by you.
Namely? Landesman looked very pleased with her, and with himself.
We have training. We all do, or used to do, jobs that require the giving and receiving of orders. Jobs that rely on discipline and a chain of command.
Go on.
Fred here, she gestured at Zhang, was a Hong Kong cop. I was a cop. I'm looking at Miss Mahmood over there, and I'm pretty sure she is, or was, a cop as well.
Zaina Mahmood's eyes widened.
How the blooming heck did you...
Instinct. Takes one to know one. I call it copdar. And how you wear your hair, that short plait of yours, very WPC. Greater Manchester Police?
The eyes widened still further.
You're Mancunian, Sam shrugged. It wasn't rocket science. Therese is also police. Royal Canadian Mounted, yes?
Hamel nodded. Sam looked at Ramsay.
Rick, I reckon, is American military. If you pushed me to narrow it down, I'd have to go with Navy.
Ramsay twisted up the corner of his mouth.
U.S. Marine Corps. Not bad.
It's the way you stood on the boat, Sam said. You looked at home, and the way you stand generally.
Good to know you've been studying my physique so closely.
As for Soleil, she told us herself she's a guerrilla fighter. Maybe you don't need formal training for that, but it still means working within a hierarchy, understanding the need for a command structure. Des, you said something about 13 years of taking orders, or rather not taking orders. I don't think you meant waiting tables. That tattoo on your neck, poking out above your shirt collar, is another clue. Kangaroo, crown, crossed rifles. Looks like a regimental emblem to me. Australian Army?
Barrington fired off an ironic salute at her.
Infantry man, 8th Battalion, Royal Australian Regiment. Never rose above the rank of private. Never tried to.
Kayla, American military too?
Almost. National Guard.
Thought so. That signet ring you're wearing has a military logo of some kind on it. Stars and a man carrying a musket. National Guard would have been my guess.
Sam turned to Harryhausen.
Kirstin, German Army, like your late husband.
Reservist in the Bundeswehr.
Nigel, pilot, RAF.
Well done.
Anders told us he was a tank commander, so that just leaves Darren. Darren, I'm going to go out on a limb and say SAS.
His jaw dropped a few millimetres, the prison yard facade cracking ever so slightly.
That's what you tell people at any rate. Sam went on,
first the sucker punch, now the right hook.
Truth is, you're in the territorials, weekend soldier. Or you were, till they had to kick you out.
bullseye. Darren's expression soured. He fixed her with a glare of pure venom. And then the shutters came down again. His face returned to its default setting, loose indifference.
"Miss Akehurst," Landesman exclaimed.
He applauded softly.
"A remarkable feat. Truly remarkable. Accurate on every count, including Mr. Pugh."
Darren, and his somewhat less than stellar CV. Not that we hold that against him. He has qualities that could well prove useful. But really, Sam, you don't mind if it's Sam. Lillycrap tells me you prefer it to Samantha. Really, Sam, you've excelled yourself. When it came to putting together this little assemblage of ours, your name was at the top of my list. You've shown that I wasn't wrong to rate you so highly.
I wouldn't be surprised if he spent quite a long time compiling that list, Sam said.
Fully a year's worth of work went into it. It wasn't easy. Digging up records, going through psychological profiles, locating personnel files, some of them quite confidential. One other basic requirement for selection was a good working knowledge of English at the least, and preferably native fluency.
"Well then, I'm buggered, aren't I?" laughed Barrington. "Me and the Queen's English, we're barely on speaking terms."
"Clear lines of communication are vital for the enterprise I have planned," said Landesman. "Eventually I arrived at a long list of just over 30 potential candidates. I winnowed it down to 12, my ideal 12, sent out invitations worded carefully so as to intrigue, and lo and behold, all 12 of you turned up. A very gratifying result."
"So what is it?" Ramsay said. "You've got us all here. You've dropped a few teasing hints. Now's the time for the big reveal, Chief. We've been patient. We're ready for it. I think we deserve it."
"Yes, yes, indeed," said Landesman. "Just one further moment of your time." There were groans. "I assure you, this is the very last thing. A question. One that begs a simple yes or no response. One that will determine which of you wish to proceed to the next stage, and which are happy to go no further."
"Go ahead," said Ramsay. "Shoot."
"If," Landesman said, "you had the power to kill gods, gods and monsters, would you use it?"
Chapter 5. Dropout. The room fell ponderingly silent.
"A show of hands will suffice," said Landesman.
"Kill gods," said Ramsay. "The Olympians."
"And their assorted monstrous hangers-on, that misbegotten menagerie of theirs, Typhon, the Minotaur, the Gorgons, all the rest."
"You can do that. You can give us that power."
"Let's focus on the question itself for the moment, shall we?"
"No, wait. You're seriously saying you could make it so that we, the 12 of us here on this table, could hurt the Olympians?"
"Not merely hurt. Destroy."
"Impossible," said Harryhausen. "Can't be done. Whole armies have tried and failed. I know this."
"The Olympians are hard bastards," said Barrington. "Hardest of the hard.
The stuff they can do."
"I realize it seems far-fetched," said Landesman. "Let's treat this as a hypothetical, then. A thought exercise. Given sufficient means to kill an Olympian, would you?"
"Don't tell me none of you has ever considered it. In your dreams, in your blackest, bleakest moments, you've all fantasized about it, avenging the loved ones the Olympians took from you. They've caused you such grief, such pain. It would only be natural to want to strike back at them. Of course, you've also told yourself that this is idle, wasteful speculation. Better to forget, forgive if you are able to, move on with your lives. You can't exact revenge on the Pantheon in the same way that you can't exact revenge on a tornado or an earthquake. But what if you could? What if you were presented with a chance to do just that?
would you reject it or grasp it?
Grasp.
Soleil Eto'o put up her hand.
What else have I been doing since my parents' deaths? Trying to kill Olympians wherever possible. That's what we in the resistance do. We don't succeed. With our nail bombs and our rocket-propelled grenades, we try, but we don't succeed. And mostly we wind up getting ourselves killed. But if you are telling me you know of a better way, Mr. Landesman, a way that might actually bring success, count me in.
I'm a yes, too, said Sondergaard, raising his hand. At Zealand, we gave the Olympians a fight to remember. We lost. We knew going in that we would. But we showed them that Denmark wasn't going to just sit back and let the world be taken over. I'd like another chance to make that point.
Zealand was an empty gesture, Herr Sondergaard,
Harryhausen snorted.
Were the Olympians impressed? Did they congratulate your whole country afterwards for so kindly volunteering to be crushed by them? Perhaps they were glad for the target practice.
So, you would rather we had done nothing?
I can't speak for Denmark, but I would rather Germany had done nothing. Then my Dietrich would still be alive. But it is my nation's curse always to follow its leaders, however misguided they are.
So it's a 9 from you, Frau Harryhausen, said Landesmann.
No, not a 9.
She raised a hand.
Unless this gesture of yours proves to be an empty one as well.
Trust me, it won't.
I'm in too, said Tsang. I'm not sure why, but I am.
Other hands followed his into the air. Sparks's, Chisholm's, Hamel's. That's more than half, said Landesman. Looking good so far. Anyone else? Mahmood put hers up.
Can't do any harm to find out what you're offering. I'm not promising him in this all the way, but I'm definitely interested.
Good enough. Rick, what about you? Either you're a deluded nutjob, or a nutjob hiding one hell of an ace up your sleeve. Lucky for you, I like nutjobs. Hand up. Former Gunnery Sergeant Richard Ramsey reporting for duty.
Mr. Barrington?
Ah, what the hell?
Up went one meaty paw.
You have the Barracuda's services. What's the pay like? And will there be beer?
Generous and occasionally, said Landesman. Your salaries will be enough to leave you living in reasonable comfort for the rest of your lives without having to work again. Alcohol, on the other hand, will be in limited supply. We'll make every effort to cater to all your domestic wants and needs. Mrs. Fuller, Captain Fuller's wife, makes regular trips to supermarkets on our behalf, and is happy to take orders for specific items. Booze, however, will have to be consumed in moderation, I'm afraid, and inebriation will not be tolerated at all. Rules of the house and non-negotiable.
Righto. Well, that could be a deal-breaker. I might have to reconsider.
Too late now. Miss Akehurst, Sam, it goes without saying that I'd be overjoyed to have you on board. What's the verdict? Yea or nay? Sam felt all eyes on her. The center of attention was not a place she liked to be. Once, in younger days, it had been. Not anymore.
I don't know.
Please?
You're asking me to become involved in something, something to do with the Olympians, when I've been doing my best to forget the Olympians even exist. You have no idea how difficult it's been for me, how hard I've struggled just to get close to being normal again. And then you come along, someone I don't know and have no great reason to trust.
I'll beg if I have to, Landesman said. I'll get down on my knees and kiss the hem of your robe, prostrate myself before you.
Come on, Sam, said Ramsay.
The man's prepared to humiliate himself. He wants you that bad. Don't make him do it. It's not dignified. Besides, his age, he might not be able to get up again. You know how it is with old guys and their prostates.
I am, I'll have you know, Rick, in remarkably good shape for a man of my years,
Landesman declared. In all aspects of my physical health. But still, you're right. I do want you that bad, Sam. A couple of the others made encouraging noises.
Go on, do it. Say yes.
Okay, then, Sam said eventually with a sigh, hardly believing the words were coming out of her mouth. She could always back out if she didn't like the look of what Landisman had in mind, if what he was proposing seemed too preposterous. Landisman beamed with delight. And that leaves Mr. Pugh. Darren, would you care to make it 12 out of 12? Darren Pugh made to put his hand up, but then dropped it to the tabletop, with a smile that he might have thought was impish, but looked to everyone else like a malicious leer.
Nah, he said, not interested. Mainly because if Ginger Tits there, he jerked a thumb at Sam, is in, I don't want anything to do with it. And also because, you know what? This is bollocks. All of this. Heap of utter steaming bollocks. You, Mr. Landyman, Handyman, whatever your name is, you're talking shite. You can't beat the Olympians. No one can. I don't believe you've got any marvellous plan at all. You just like the idea of thinking you do. And you've roped in all these losers, got them halfway to believe in your scheme, your fantasy, whatever this is, and nothing will come of it. You mark my words. It'll all turn out to be some half-baked nonsense, and the whole thing will fall apart. You know what you remind me of? A posh version of those blokes you hear talking down the pub. The ones who say they know how to get rid of the Olympians. This is what we should do. And they've got some huge, complicated method, use poison gas or smuggle in a suitcase nuke or some such. And if only the government would listen to them, then this whole thing would be sorted. But it's all just pie in the sky, just bullshitters bullshitting. And for all your money, your fancy invitations, your islands and your World War II bunker, you're no different from them.
That's a no, I take it.
Yeah, you could say it's a no. The only way you could kill the Olympians, I reckon, old man, is by boring them to death. Which, long-winded as you are, I wouldn't put past you. Other than that, though...
Pugh glanced around the table.
Good luck in your little happy land dream, all of you. And I'll keep an eye on the television for news reports about your bodies turning up charred and mangled in a field somewhere. That's assuming anything more comes from this meeting, which I seriously doubt will happen.
He stood up, scraping back his chair.
Now, I'd like to leave, if you wouldn't mind. I've been here long enough, and I don't enjoy being kept in places where I don't want to stay.
I'll bet you don't, Sam muttered under her breath.
What?
Pugh rounded on her.
What did he just say?
He took a step towards her, squaring his shoulders. Ramsay stood up, ready to lunge.
I asked you a question, she-pig!
Pugh spat.
What did you just say?
Sam locked gazes with him, at the same time discreetly motioning to Ramsay not to intervene. She could handle this. She'd fronted down far larger and far angrier men in the past.
You don't like being detained against your will, Mr. Pugh, she said. That's understandable. So go. Go now. Don't make a fuss about it. No one wants any trouble.
Pugh took another step closer to her. His head was twitching. His eyes flicked to a table knife, just within reach. Not particularly sharp, but a usable weapon all the same.
But if you do want trouble, Sam went on evenly, then I will give it to you. Come at me with that table knife, and I will break your wrist before you even get near me. Then I will break your elbow. Then I will break your nose. And while you're down on the floor screaming like a little girl, I will take out one of your ankles. And then I will get started on your crotch, and not in a good way. And if you ever want to walk normally again, walk now. Straight past me. Out of that door, and don't come back. That's the one safe, sane course of action open to you right now. Try anything else, and you will regret it.
She kept her voice low, steady, to indicate that she meant every word she said. It was no bluff. She did. Pugh weighed up his options. He could fathom only one way out of this that didn't involve losing face.
Fuck it, you're not worth it, he growled. Anyway, I don't hit women.
Sam wondered if Pugh's estranged wife, were she still alive, might have had something different to say about that.
I'm off.
Pugh headed for the door, skirting round the table on the opposite side from where Sam sat. Landesman moved to intercept him.
Darren, I'm sorry it has to be this way, but as a token of my appreciation and by way of recompense for your time and inconvenience...
He produced a checkbook, one of those furnished by the kind of bank that did not have high street branches, the kind that had perhaps one premises in a Georgian townhouse in the City of London, another in Switzerland, and a third on a Caribbean island with malleable tax laws. He also produced a Mont Blanc pen. A quick scribble, a rip of perforations, and Pugh was holding a cheque for a sum whose size was sufficient to transform his normally tight-slitted mouth into a wide, gap-toothed grin.
"It was no inconvenience at all, Mr. Landesman," he said, folding the cheque and tucking it into a back pocket. "For that kind of dosh, you want me to come and waste a day here again? Just call, any time."
Lillycrap was waiting in the corridor outside to escort Pugh upstairs. Landesman turned back to the remaining 11. "No great loss," he said. His lack of disappointment seemed entirely unfeigned.
"I knew he'd be 50-50, and his antipathy towards Sam would have been an almost insurmountable obstacle. We're better off without him. Besides, one dropout out of 12 isn't bad. Now, if you'd all care to follow me, I have something to show you. The wait is over. This is where you learn that I am not, as Rick put it, a deluded nutjob, nor, in Darren Pugh's parlance, a bullshitter. I am the enabler of your vengeances, and, quite possibly, the saviour of the world."
Chapter 6. Titan. They were, Sam judged, perhaps half a mile to the east of the bunker entrance, which put them somewhere on the far side of the island, maybe even right at its opposite shore. They were in a chamber that could have comfortably housed a football pitch, with a rugged, arched ceiling that had been dynamited out of the solid rock. She had the sense that the chamber was deep underground, but still above sea level, the hilliness of the island affording a significantly thick protective layer all around. Her guess would be that the far wall formed the inside of a sheer cliff. She could dimly hear waves pounding against the other side, with that heavy booming impact that suggested they were breaking against a vertical surface rather than a slanted one. A substantial proportion of that same wall was taken up by a mural, a copy of a Renaissance painting she recognized. It depicted two naked Greek gods, one young, one old, the former hacking at the latter's crotch with a scythe, while various other disrobed divinities sat around looking on in postures of horror and despair. All of these huge figures had lumpen, fleshy physiques, and in the background was an image of the earth enclosed in a spherical golden cage that presumably stood for the universe. Sam couldn't at that moment recall which myth the painting represented. The artist's name likewise escaped her. Michelangelo? The chamber itself, however, was of lesser importance than what it contained. It contained a handful of technicians, most dressed in casual wear, a couple in denim coveralls. It contained desks with flat-screen computer stations hooked up to one another by high-density cables, and each with its own array of gonks, action figures, toys, pinned-up postcards and photos, geek territorial markers. It contained heavy-duty industrial workbenches littered with tools such as screwdriver sets and soldering irons. Above all, it contained 12 pod-like units arranged in a circle, each downlit by a shaft of powerful light, and standing in these columns of illumination, held erect by mannequin-style armatures cradled by the pods, were what appeared to be suits of armor. Utterly modern, sleekly high-tech, but still to all intents and purposes, suits of armor. A medieval knight would have had no problem recognizing them as such. They had helmets, breastplates, gauntlets, greaves, boots, separate sections that would have to be donned one at a time, most likely with the assistance of the latter-day equivalent of a squire. They were coated in a matte gunmetal grey substance, which from a distance looked like paint, but closer too resembled Hessian. There was also an armory in the chamber, an array of weaponry mounted on racks and shelves, dozens upon dozens of guns, rifles, rocket launchers and the like. Enough, all told, to equip a small army, and included in it were items the like of which Sam had never seen before, and whose function she couldn't identify. The chamber was, in all, a command center of some kind, kitted out for war. The suits of armor were the centerpiece, the thing that commanded one's attention. Certainly they were what Landesman wanted to show off. "Ladies, gentlemen, you see before you the fruits of 3 years of research and development, 2 years of construction, and another year of rigorous, painstaking testing. The name for them is Total Immersion Tactical Armor with Nanotech, a somewhat clunky sobriquet, but we had to do it back to front, making the initial letters conform to an acronym rather than, as is more common, the acronym arising organically from the product's qualities. The acronym, of course, being TITAN, Titan. Landesman waved a hand around him at the suits, a ringmaster flourish. The Titan battlesuit is, quite simply, the ultimate in combat gear. I could waffle on for hours about the compact servo motors, the nanotech body protection, the onboard computer-aided control system, the variable mode head-up display, the GPS transponder triangulation, and I'd still be barely touching on what the suit is capable of. I have sunk everything into this. All my years of experience in the field of arms and armaments, all the knowledge of these outstandingly clever men and women you see at work here, the very cream of my Daedalus workforce, not to mention funds totaling nearly $500 million American dollars. Barrington whistled through his teeth. Ramsay said, "That's got to put a crimp in the mortgage payments." Landesman gave a wry look. "I am, I'll admit, a person of somewhat reduced net worth as a consequence of this project. Half the man I used to be, financially. But I wouldn't have invested so heavily in it if I didn't believe the cause was just."
"And you can always sell on the technology to someone else in the future,"
Harryhausen observed.
"I imagine if these suits do all you say, if they really are the ultimate in combat gear, certain nations will pay handsomely to get their hands on them. Your outlay would be well rewarded."
"There is that, too," Landesman conceded. "I already told you I am not a philanthropic man. At least, not wholly. But believe me, in this instance, the philanthropy comes first. The potential recouping of expenditure with interest is just a bonus." Eto'o went over to inspect one of the battlesuits. Before she got there, one of the technicians in coveralls hurried into her path.
"Please don't touch," he said, the anxiety in his voice softened somewhat by an East Coast Scottish lilt.
"I was only going to look. Why, is it delicate? Will it shatter like an eggshell?"
"No, of course not."
"Then what is the problem?"
"I just..."
Landesman clasped the young man's shoulder. "Jamie, it's all right. Soleil can touch it if she wants to."
"I'm sorry, sir."
"Don't be. You're only being protective. It's very admirable. Everyone, allow me to introduce you. This mother hen is Jamie McCann, our chief engineer and all-round fixer of things that need fixing."
"Hi,"
McCann said with a nervous bob of the head.
"McCann, the manic mechanic, that's me."
Jamie basically built the suits from scratch with his own fair hands. They're my brainchild, but it's his sweat and elbow grease that gave them shape and reality.
"Feels strange," said Eto'o,
running her fingers over the battlesuit's exterior.
"Rough and smooth at the same time."
"That's the nanotech you're feeling," said McCann. "Billions of wee sub-microscopic bots impregnated into the outer layer of the armor's indurated polycarbonate. They're inert right now. But when activated, they can do two things. One, they can color shift. Two, they can..."
"Jamie," said Landesman, interrupting, "instead of telling everyone what the Titan suits can do, why don't we go one better?"
"You mean a practical demo?"
McCann looked hesitant. "You've done 100 of them.
in front of people.
Now's not the time for stage fright. Some of these good folk have journeyed a long way to be here today. Let's make it worth their while. We'll put a suit through its paces so they can get a proper idea of what they're signing up for. Chapter 7. Practical Demo. It took McCann half an hour to get the Titan suit on. First, he had to squeeze into a one-piece lycra body stocking. Not very flattering as undergarments went, but he said anything else resulted in severe chafing. Next came the battlesuit itself, piece by piece. Multiple Velcro straps had to be fastened, wires had to be connected up, fitting adjustments had to be made. A full preliminary diagnostics check had to be run. Finally, he was all set. The battlesuit looked bulky but was, he assured his audience of 11, surprisingly light. The heaviest part of it was the liquid hydrocarbon fuel cell that was attached to the back, a smoothly contoured semi-ovoid that sat between the shoulder blades and contributed no more than 15 pounds to the overall weight. Besides, he added, the servos compensated. Once operational, they enhanced the wearer's natural strength. By how much? The calculations weren't precise, but he estimated at least threefold. One of the other technicians, who had helped McCann into the suit, clapped him on the helmet.
You're good to go. Power up.
Commencing power-up sequence. McCann tapped a wrist-mounted touchscreen control pad. A low whine filled the air. He lowered his helmet visor. A blister of tinted acrylic glass that covered his face down to the helmet's chin guard.
HUD online, McCann announced, voice slightly muffled. You won't be able to see anything as the visor is coated with a partially reflective film, like a two-way mirror. Chorus systems analysis readouts populating. Signal strength of wireless connection between suit and helmet CPU confirmed. Everything at nominal. The display is controlled by a voice recognition command system, as is the suite of vision modes. There's no mic, incidentally. The helmet picks up your voice through sound sensors attuned to cranial cavity vibrations. Here we go. Visor options menu up. Available modes are night vision, thermal imaging, and peripheral expansion. Thermal. There, I've just switched to thermal imaging. And you lot are now rainbow people. It's kind of like being on magic mushrooms. Not that I've done magic mushrooms lately. I mean, ever. Not that I've done magic mushrooms ever. I'll stop talking now.
Now X-ray vision? Said Barrington.
Damn, I wouldn't have minded a chance to see through Sam's clothing.
I'd pay not to see through yours, Des, Sam retorted.
Ouch, said Ramsay with a chuckle. You do not cross the Akehurst.
You do not, Sam agreed. Yes, anyway, said McCann. First off, a show of strength. See that workbench over there? It's solid wood and tempered steel. How much do you reckon it weighs?
Shade over a couple of 100 pounds, said Ramsay.
Watch this.
McCann strode over to the workbench, the suit servos whirring just audibly with every step. He moved with ease, not looking at all like someone encased in armor. With one hand, he grabbed the end of the workbench and lifted. The bench came up off the floor with no apparent effort from him. He lowered it again, all four of its feet touching down with a chunky clang.
Next, speed. How far is it to that mural, would you say?
100 meters, volunteered Chisholm, give or take.
Anyone got a stopwatch?
Sparks's wristwatch had a stopwatch function.
Time me.
McCann went into a half crouch. Sparks said go, and he launched himself forwards. His first couple of steps were slow and laboured, then all at once the suit seemed to realise what was being required of it, and he accelerated to a sprint. The fastest sprint Sam had ever seen. He skidded to a halt just short of the mural, and Sparks announced,
6.4 seconds!
McCann raised both fists, as though acknowledging the cheers of an imaginary stadium crowd.
And Jamie McCann, the young contender from Kirkcaldy, takes the gold, smashing the previous world record to pieces.
Jamie, said Landesman, mock reproving.
Sorry, Mr. Landesman.
McCann returned at walking pace. The suit can sustain speeds of up to 40 miles per hour for up to 6 or 7 minutes before the servos start to overheat. Although you want to be careful because it drains the battery like you wouldn't believe. Use speed sparingly. That's the motto.
Is that another drugs reference, Jamie?
Said Sam.
No, no, God, no. Please don't get the wrong idea. I'm not some junkie.
Watch out, pal, said Ramsay. Sam used to be a cop.
I know,
McCann squirmed.
I mean, I know some of you were police. I just... You can't be arrested for just saying stuff, can you?
Continue with the demonstration, lad, said Landesman. You're doing fine. They're only teasing.
Oh, I see.
Show us the chameleon effect.
Yeah, the chameleon effect. Well, it goes a bit like this. The nanobots can color shift to match their surroundings. It isn't quite Harry Potter's cloak of invisibility, but it's still a hell of an effective camouflage. Here we go.
He stood against the black rock wall of the chamber. A quick prodding of his wrist pad, and the surface of the suit began to darken. Soon the suit was as black as the wall, and with McCann standing stock still, it was almost impossible to see him. He was a perfect silhouette.
It can also do breakup patterns, he said, as the suit lightened again to its default setting, grey. Jungle, desert, mountain, snow, all the basic combat camouflage designs. Urban environments are harder to deal with, but by and large, buildings in localized regions conform to a standard color. So for a Mediterranean town, for instance, you can make the setting white to match the stucco. And speaking of Mediterranean and hot countries in general, we've fitted a microclimate conditioning subsystem, which will keep you cool in 100-plus degree heat and toasty warm in sub-zero temperatures. Basically, you'll never roast or freeze. Whatever the weather, you'll be baby bear's porridge. Just right.
Ah, oh, bless, said Mahmood.
McCann squirmed again. He was a full-grown man and clearly some kind of genius, but emotionally arrested at the awkward adolescent age. It was almost too easy to embarrass him, and too tempting. And now, said Landesman, the pièce de résistance. McCann made an imploring sound.
Do we have to?
I'm afraid so, Jamie.
But it hurts.
Oh, it's not so bad. Didn't you like it once to getting shot with a paintball?
Which hurts?
Stings.
Hurts, stingingly. Oh, very well then, since you insist. You're the fellow who signs the checks after all.
McCann stationed himself at the wall again, while Landesman fetched a gun from the armory. You may want to step back a little, Landesman advised the 11. There shouldn't be a ricochet, but just in case.
What in the name of sweet baby Jesus's little holy halo is that?
Ramsay asked, pointing to the gun. Never seen anything like it. The gun was shaped like a conventional rifle, but had a long, thickly cylindrical barrel and an unusually stocky body. The casing was ribbed in several places, and a lightning bolt was stenciled on a small sliding cover on one side, suggesting a battery pack was contained within. This, said Landesman, is a handheld coil gun.
A handheld what now?
Come, come, Mr. Ramsay, don't tell me you're unaware of your own Defense Department's current holy grail. A handheld coil gun. One better than a railgun. Not so power-intensive and producing far less excess heat. Unlike a conventional gun, a coil gun uses electromagnetic energy rather than explosive energy to launch a projectile. A series of coaxial superconductor solenoid coils switching on and off in sequence accelerate a bullet along a track until it emerges here. Landesman tapped the end of the barrel at a speed of several times Mach. The bullet is powderless, contained in a sabot case that separates free the moment it leaves the gun. In all, this has twice the range of the average rifle and five times the penetration and stopping power.
He smacked the magazine into place, then pulled the cocking handle, raised the coil gun to his shoulder, and took aim.
"So you're going to shoot him with that sci-fi blaster of yours," said Ramsey, "at almost point-blank range."
"I am. Why ever not?"
"Shit, you can't. You just can't. Even if there's a whole bunch of Kevlar in that armor, there's still a good chance you'll..."
The report from the coil gun was a tremendous percussive snap. As the ringing in everyone's ears faded, all gazes turned to McCann, who had staggered when the gun went off, but who remained upright and appeared unharmed. He stooped and retrieved something that lay at his feet. He held it up between thumb and forefinger for all to see. It was a bullet, blunted to a mushroom shape.
"The bots make the suit go rigid at the point of impact," McCann said, flipping up his visor. "They absorb and disperse the force of the bullet across the surrounding surface, wherever you're hit. Not pain-free," he added with feeling, "but ow is definitely preferable to, you know."
He made a gargling noise in the back of his throat, like someone fatally wounded.
"And that, ladies and gentlemen, concludes our demonstration of the Titan suit. At least I hope it does, unless my boss has plans to break out the rocket launcher."
"Would you like to give it a try, Jamie?"
"Jesus, no, I was joking."
"As was I." Landesman smiled paternally at the engineer. "Off you go. You've done well. Back into your civvies." McCann went over to the other technicians, who began helping him divest himself of the suit. Landesman, meanwhile, returned the coil gun to the armory, then addressed his 11 recruits again.
"So, you've seen the battle suit in action. What do you think?"
"That's supposed to make us superior to the Olympians," said Harryhausen.
"What is the single greatest disadvantage an ordinary person has against the Olympians?" Landesman asked rhetorically.
"Vulnerability. The Titan suits do away with that.
They compensate for the relative physical weakness of us mere humans by giving us a sturdy, almost impregnable exoskeleton. I'm not suggesting that wearing one would allow you to go toe-to-toe with, say, Hercules, trading punches, but it would afford protection from the worst of any damage he tried to inflict, and its stealth capability would allow you to sneak up on him, and night vision would enable you to do so under cover of darkness. And you've seen the kind of cutting-edge weapons available here. I'm not offering unqualified superiority to the Pantheon. What I am offering is a significantly leveled playing field."
"But there's just 11 of us," said Barrington. "And how many of them?"
12, not counting the monsters," said Chisholm. "The standard canonical dodecatheon. Plus Hercules and Dionysus, who are in the cos dodecatheon, but not the canonical. Hercules, by tradition, is a demigod, but he still counts. Then there's Argus. Nobody's quite sure which he is, mainly because nobody's ever seen him, god or monster or something in between. So depending on how you look at it, you could say there are 13 in all, 13 and a half, even 14 and a half.
"And each of them, each of the main ones, is worth a regiment of soldiers at least," said Barrington. "I mean, Hamlet here fought with a whole army against just half a dozen, and look how that turned out."
Sondergaard scowled at the Australian.
"Hamlet.
Only famous Dane I could think of, mate.
Hans Christian Andersen, Kierkegaard, Niels Bohr, Karen Blix.
Mate, you should be grateful I've heard of any Danes at all. I'm just saying your country's entire armed forces took on 6 Olympians and lost. That's however many battalions, and the 11 of us wouldn't even make a company. Sorry, Landesman, super suits or not, the maths just doesn't add up."
"But it isn't just about the suits, Des," Landesman said smoothly. "It'll be the tactics as well. I've a strategy mapped out that Athena herself would be proud of. A handful of Titan troops going up against the Olympians in a full frontal assault would be, I grant you, futile, tantamount to suicide. A series of low-key guerrilla-style attacks, on the other hand, picking them off one by one.
Eto'o's ears pricked up.
"They wander the world," she said. "They're not always to be found on Mount Olympus. They argue among themselves too often for all of them to stay there all of the time. They're often alone."
"Precisely, and I'd be drawing particularly on your know-how, Soleil, your experience and expertise in the field of counter-Olympian insurgency."
"I would be happy to share it."
"I'm asking," Landesman said to all 11 of them, "for 6 months of your lives. That's how long I envisage this taking. 6 months to rid the world of the Olympian scourge. 6 months to restore humanity's control of its own destiny. In the ancient myths, it was the gods who rose up against the Titans. The Titans were the children of Uranus, powerful, primeval creatures he could not control. Their name itself derives from the Greek verb taino, meaning I strain, because according to Hesiod in his Theogony, they strained in insolence. They rampaged around, uncontrollable. Zeus was the son of one of them, Cronus. Cronus had a habit of eating his offspring, swallowing them whole so that none of them could turn on him and depose him. But Zeus managed to escape that fate. He forced Cronus to vomit up his fellow gods, then enlisted their aid in attacking him. So began the Titanomachy, the War of the Titans. Sorry, am I boring you, Dez?"
"Nah, mate, don't mind me. You carry on. I always yawn when I'm fascinated."
"That war lasted 10 years. Eventually, the immortals overthrew the Titans and took their place as rulers of the world. The Titans were imprisoned in the bowels of the earth, and Zeus, well, he castrated his father."
"Is that what's going on in that charming picture over there?" said Ramsay, indicating the mural. "Is that Zeus with that Batman scythe?"
The blade of the scythe was black and curiously batwing-shaped. If Batman ever had need of a pre-technological farming implement, it would surely look like the one in the painting.
"Ah, no," said Landesman. "There is no famous image of the castration of Cronus, unfortunately. So what you're looking at is a reproduction of Vasari's fresco, The Castration of Uranus. It's Cronus who's doing the testicular lopping off there, and his father, Uranus, who's the poor fellow being deprived of his assets. In that respect, Zeus, when he chose to remove Cronus's testicles, was simply following on in a patrilinear tradition. Apparently a lot of that sort of thing went on between the gods and their daddies. It's a recurring motif." "Paging Dr. Freud," said Hamel.
"Indeed," said Landesman.
"Don't tell me," said Ramsay. "There's some kind of code hidden in the picture, right? Some historical message that reveals the secret of the Olympians. Dan Brown's working on the novel even as we speak."
"I'm afraid the answer's no. Although it's an ingenious guess. There's no code, no secret message. The painting is just a painting, albeit a splendid and rather beautiful one. Oh, and by the way, the blade of the scythe looks like that because it's supposed to be made of napped flint. Most pre-Bronze Age tools used flint, Vasari's point being that the myth is ancient, even by classical standards."
"So, what's the mural up there for?" Sam asked.
"If it's to cheer up the workplace, you'd probably have been better off with a picture of Daniel Craig or a kitten in a tree instead."
"I had it painted there as a, you could say, as a source of inspiration," replied Landesman. "A reminder of God's natures, their cruelty, their vindictiveness. What I'm actually intending to do, with the help of you people, is to invert the Titan story. An act of symmetry. I'm proposing Titanomachy 2, an uprising of Titans against the gods, or whatever the Olympians actually are. And just as Zeus and his Olympian cohort succeeded in defeating the Titans, I fully anticipate that events in the real world will mirror myth. You, my Titans, will defeat the Olympians. If, that is, you're willing. Are you?
now that you've some idea of the resources you'll have at your disposal, the level of logistical and technological support I'll be able to provide, are you up for this? Half a year to eliminate the entire Pantheon and lay to rest the ghosts that haunt you. Come on, what do you say? Nothing. Tell you what, Landisman continued, unfazed. I'll give you a week to decide. You start training with the battlesuits tomorrow, testing out some of the weaponry as well. Tomorrow, said Ramsay. Isn't that kind of soon? Some of us have lives, you know. We can't drop everything and start working for you just like that. Is that so, Mr. Ramsay? I dare say you, for one, could put everything on hold, close down your life with just a couple of phone calls.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.